What's up, YouTube fam? I hope your week is off to as good of a start as mine is. This is the first week that I've had since quarantine where I have been alone at home. My wife returned to work, my kids went to daycare, and here I am. Just honestly, I'm kind of freaking out because I feel like there should just be chaos all around me, and now it's just quiet, and it's totally weird. But anyways, I've been super productive this week, and I wanted to give you a little update about what's been going on. This week has been focusing on rounding out the JNCIP service provider, talking about MPLS VPNs. In particular, I covered VPLS this week. Now, next week, I'm going to finish the course by recording eVPN, but I just got done wrapping up some huge recording on VPLS, and I just got done eating a gigantic meatball po' boy at my favorite deli here in town, Anthony's Italian Deli. So what better time to sit down and talk about MPLS VPNs than when I feel most fat? That's what we're going to do in this video, is I'm going to try and break down what the real power of an MPLS VPN is. Let's get going. So let me tell you right now that MPLS VPNs are a massive, massive, massive topic. If you've never dealt with MPLS VPNs before, this is something that will take you probably a few hours to wrap your head around how they work. And trying to summarize in a very quick video how MPLS VPNs just work is going to be an impossible feat, yet I will attempt the impossible in this video. MPLS VPNs are so stinking powerful, and what I want to convey to you is, what do they really do? Why are they so powerful? And the big name of this video is, what is the real magic behind why MPLS VPNs are so powerful? Let's get going talking about what MPLS VPNs really bring to the table for our customers as a service provider, as well as what we as a customer may want to expect from them, and then understand what is the real tech that's really taking place here underneath the hood. I'll see you there. Okay, bear with me one second here because I've got a new setup that's gonna be a new toy. We got a green screen effect that I'm playing with here. It's still got some tweaking. You can see the box doesn't look perfect, but we're gonna have some fun with this. So let me show you the topology that I just used when I wrapped up recording on VPLS, Virtual Private LAN Service. And you're not supposed to know what VPLS is for this video. You're not supposed to know what that acronym means, but maybe you've heard of this thing called VPNs. Now, customers, when they deploy VPNs, they have a couple different options. They can either do it themselves, or they could pay the service provider to do it. Since I think most people have more familiarity with deploying a VPN themselves, what do you think the goal of this VPN would be? Here I've got customer one, they're this pink customer, and they've got four different sites here in the topology. What they're trying to do is, let's just say for site one, they're trying to build a VPN over to site two. So maybe they've got a LAN segment on either side. Look, they got a little server here. So maybe what's really going on is customers who are sitting on their desktop, you know, the clients are sitting on their desktop, they want to reach the server privately, across the way at a different site. So what they'll try to do is they'll try to build a VPN tunnel from this router's interface here to this router's interface here, and then share prefixes back and forth, you know, doing it the way they've always done with maybe routing protocols like OSPF or ISIS or EIGRP if they're in the Cisco world. The thing is sometimes customers are very, very, very large and they have a lot of money, but maybe they don't necessarily have the resources to keep up with just this WAN infrastructure, to keep up with all of these different changes. Now, SD-WAN is taking over in that regard and helping administrators out a lot to where we can deploy things like a site-to-site infrastructure very easily. However, what has happened in the past up to this point is the customers have gone to the service provider and they have requested that they want to deploy a VPN, but they don't want to do it themselves. They want the service provider to do it. Let me say that. So in this case, the service provider says, well, you've got a few different options. You know, if you think about your traditional site-to-site VPN, like you've done in the past, like this, what does it do? We form a connection right here on these WAN-facing interfaces, and then we share routing prefixes using OSPF or EIGRP or ISIS, basically saying what is on the LAN side of our interfaces. And when customers or clients want to ping devices on the remote site, that's how they've learned how to do it. It says just go over the tunnel. Well, in the case of an MPLS layer 3 VPN, The exact same thing is happening here. This customer wants to share prefixes to our device, our service provider device. And this site, this router here, wants to share prefixes to this provider device. And then they just want those prefixes to make their way through the backbone all the way over here to this other remote device, and vice versa, going in this direction. That way they could say like, hey, if I have a LAN client that wants to access that server at a different site, I know to just send that prefix or that data into my provider edge, and they'll know how to send it all the way through their backbone over to my remote site. Cool. That is the essence of a VPN at the end of the day. If you think about it, there's V, P, and N. The V stands for virtual. So the customer wants to see a logical network built on top of the service provider network. It is a virtual network that sits on top of the service provider network. But the P, what's a big deal? Let's think about that P for 1 second. What is that P all about? Private. Okay. Well, in the example where I was just talking about that, the customer was talking about sharing prefixes into PE1. So if we were to do something like run OSPF between the provider edge and the customer equipment, what would then happen if we didn't configure anything else? Well, all of our customers' routes would then be in our global routing table, the service provider's global routing table. That's no good. We don't want to do that. That's going to be a huge problem. So we need to keep privacy in mind here. But now we're going to shift a little bit and talk about, well, wait a minute, we have privacy in mind, but then what happens when, oh, we've picked up another customer here in the mix. They have a bunch of sites. This is going to be our blue customer. They have a bunch of sites too, and they also want to deploy VPN services with us. Now that privacy becomes an even bigger deal because we don't want our customers' prefixes to also be accessible by our other customers' prefixes. Now we've got a real challenge of privacy on our hands here. And this is where MPLS VPNs can start to lay the foundation about why or how this is really just a magical solution for us at the end of the day. So let me switch back to my black color here, and we're gonna talk about it like this. In fact, let me hide my head entirely. We don't need to see Nox anymore right now. Let's take a moment to examine how MPLS works on its own by itself right now before we get into the real power of MPLS VPNs. With MPLS, the idea is that the CE1R2 over here on site 2 or CE1R1 over here on site 1 can advertise prefixes over to provider edge 2. And the provider edge 2 can then say throughout the entire topology, look, if you're trying to get to one of these prefixes, just send me a packet with a label, something like a label of 1000. So the cool thing about it is provider 1, core, and provider 2, they never actually have to learn our customers' routes. They never have to because of the way the label works. You see, MPLS is often referred to as layer 2.5 because it comes right here. We've got the frame, which we know is layer 2, and then we've got the packet, which we know is layer 3, but we shimmy our label right here in between the middle of them. So PE1 can learn about these remote prefixes, and it can say like, okay, well, if I'm trying to get data from this site over here to this site over here, I can just shimmy in a label of 1000, because that's what PE2 is expecting, in between the frame and the packet. So PE1 then sends it down to P1, and this is where it gets pretty cool. P1 looks at the frame and it says, yeah, I see that this frame is destined for me, because we know how layer 2 works. We just swap out the MAC addresses as it goes one step through the chain. But then it can inspect the label. And in this case, it sees a label of 1000, and it knows the 1000 label was advertised by PE2. So P1 says, okay, well, I see I've got this label of 1000. I know I need to send it outbound towards the core. So I'm just going to punt it out this interface. Notice at no point did it ever look above layer 2.5. It never looked at layer 3 to make a forwarding decision. No, it made its forwarding decision based on the label. This is actually one of the cool things about MPLS. This is why it was created, is because it's very, very fast. It just looks at a label and it knows send it out this interface. Then core receives it. It looks at the label and it says, ah, yeah, I see this label of 1000. I'm going to send it out this interface. And then P2 says, oh, I see this label here. I know how to handle it from here. That's really the magic of MPLS label switching in the first place, is now these devices don't make forwarding decisions above the label. And you'll see why that's a big deal as we come, you know, towards the end of this video when we start talking about how like things like layer 2 VPNs work. So in this case, only the provider edges really need to know the customer's routes, because then we can share labels throughout the topology about how to reach these devices. And our core and our center devices never actually have to learn customer prefixes at all. They just need to know, how do I get this data to PE2? They say, I've received this packet that's got this label. I'm going to send it out this interface. And that's where the buck stops. So at no point does it say, like, I have to look at the packet and the layer 4 information to figure out my forwarding system. No, it just looks at the label and says, okay, if it's this label, send it out that interface. This is actually one of the biggest reasons the MPLS was created, is because it's so stinking fast. It's so stinking scalable and fast, and that's a really cool thing about MPLS. So now the interesting thing is we have one way to get a customer's traffic from one site to the next by using label switching. That's what this is called, is we just inspect the label and figure out how to move it forward. But let's rethink about this one second. Now my core devices, P1, core, and P2, they don't care about the layer 3 information. However, on my provider edge devices, they have multiple customers, right? And what's to stop a customer from running a subnet that's something like 192.168.1.0/24? Customer 1 absolutely has every right to run that prefix, but guess what? So does our blue customer. So if PE2 receives that packet, it receives that thing and says label 1000, and it looks at label 1000 and says, oh, that is destined for me. However, I see that it's destined for 192.168.1. Which customer does it go to? Because they're both running the same prefix. This is when we have to introduce something called routing instances. In other vendors' terms, they call this a VRF. And it is basically a virtualized router. It is a private routing instance, a private router just for that customer. And another way to put it is a private routing table just for that customer. So if I use pink for customer one, I'll put these two interfaces in a routing instance, and I'll call that routing instance customer one. And if I use blue for these made up interfaces, I'll create a routing instance called customer two. Now, all of the interfaces that I've configured to connect to those customers are now tightly coupled with this routing instance. They're now privately held inside of this routing instance. And no prefixes, no routes, or no frames, no MAC addresses that we've learned in one routing instance, like customer one's routing instance, will ever make its way into customer two's routing instance unless we go through a whole lot of configuration to make that happen. It is possible, but by default, it doesn't happen. The same can even be said with our global route table. Think about that. You say show route. What do you see? You see routes. Well, here's the thing. Routes, when we have a prefix, when somebody in our global route table is trying to ping customer one, or customer one is trying to ping into the global route table, it doesn't happen by default. They're literally separated routers, and they're not sharing prefixes or routes between each other. They're truly separated. So the crazy thing happens is this is the real power behind MPLS VPNs. We've got the ability to take a packet or a frame from PE1 to PE2. Actually, let me clean up the screen because this is big. We've got the ability to take a packet now from PE1 and send it over to PE2 using label switching. These core devices do not care about what is above that label. They just want to know what's the interface they should send the packet out of. So, but PE2 receives that and it looks at label 1000 and says, well, that's me, but I don't know which route table to look up in. This is where the magic of MPLS VPNs comes in. It comes with the fact that we can actually do something called label stacking. When PE1 actually generates this data to be sent over to PE2, it's going to apply an outer label. I think we said it was 1000 in our example. So that way these core devices, when they look up, how do I send this packet forward? They just look up the first label that comes in the header. It's the outer label and it says 1000. Okay, out that interface. But then PE2 has an additional label that it advertised directly to PE1. And this is the label that is associated with a specific customer's routing instance. So when we create customer ones, I'm just running out of space here, aren't I? Oh, now I can't even type anything. My pen's all messed up here. There we go. When I create my specific routing instance for customer one, I'll generate an additional label. And anyone that is actually participating in this MPLS VPN, maybe I'll make up the label 10,000, when they actually want to reach customer one's routing instance and send data out to customer one, they're gonna send in an additional label. So that way, when I receive this frame or this packet, I'll have the ability to say, okay, well, I don't care about the outer label anymore. Show me the inner label. And the inner label says, oh, this is really what instance, what routing instance this MPLS VPN is really associated with. And this is the foundation of how MPLS VPNs really work at the end of the day. Now, there's a bunch of different flavors of MPLS VPNs. We've been talking a lot about the Layer 3 VPN, where Customer Edge 1 R1 forms an OSPF adjacency to our provider edge device and shares routes to us. And our job is to get those routes across this backbone over to the other customer edge device. Now we see there are a couple different ways that we can privately do that. What's really going on in the hood is a special type of BGP called multi-protocol BGP. And that's all about how these routes and prefixes can be advertised back and forth. But when the time for to actually move the data through our core, it's all about MPLS label stacking. And we've been talking about layer 3 VPNs, but there are also layer 2 VPNs. Where, in this case, if I clean up the screen, if the customer doesn't want to run an OSPF adjacency with us and actually share routes to us, they just want to see us as more or less an Ethernet switch. We can do that too. Because one of the cool things about the label stacking is if you think about how it was stacked before, we had frame, and then we had label, and then we had the packet, right? And then above the packet is the transport layer. Look, here's the thing. P1, core, and P2, they're only looking at the label. So what can come after that? Really anything. We can absolutely have a frame, then our labels, I should say labels, because it's gonna be an inner and an outer label, and then we can have another frame. Yeah, that's right. We can absolutely carry layer 2 connectivity from this E00 interface to this E00 interface. That way they can believe that they're on a gigantic Ethernet segment. And then beyond that, we can turn our entire backbone at this point into one gigantic Ethernet switch so the customer can connect all of their sites into the service provider backbone, and they just see each other. They see their own router devices from all of their sites as one gigantic, basically one gigantic broadcast domain. The technologies that bring this to life, where it's like a gigantic Ethernet switch, are called VPLS or EVPN. And you've no doubt heard of EVPN because you see it in things like enterprises and data centers now. EVPN is oftentimes used as the control plane for VXLAN in the data center. Yeah, service providers can now use EVPN to bring this switch-like experience to the customer. So the cool thing is now when we label switch things across the core, we're still going, even if it's layer two, we're still going to have an outer label just so our core devices know how to get it to a provider edge. Then the provider edge can strip off the inner, it can look at the inner label and say, oh, I see I've got this inner label that's associated with this exact customer. And this exact customer, now I can look at the MAC address table and say like, oh, okay, I see the interface that I learned this MAC address on. Let me send it out that way. So this is the power of MPLS VPNs. This is an absolutely massive topic, and we have hours upon hours upon hours of content explaining how this all really works under the hood. All of the different flavors of VPNs, MPLS VPNs that you can deploy in a service provider environment. How do they really work? What do the packets really look like? And how do you configure and validate them on the Junos command line? This is all towards your JNCIP service provider. So that's been my take on MPLS VPNs. Thanks for stopping by, y'all. I'll see you in the next one.